Great to be here again. So we're in the AI and machine learning track. So why do we want to talk about productionization then? If you don't go to production, you won't have any value. Right? That's why we call this talk AnalyticsOps. The path to production is electricity to machine learning and deep learning. So, data science. You saw it in the opening talks, how many data scientists there are. That's amazing. That's really, really cool. It's a really, really good development. However, there's been so much focus on the data scientists alone, the sexiest job of the 20th century. Honestly, we need to start focusing on one person or a team of data scientists. Analytics itself, because that's what they're doing, needs to be seen as a part of the entire operations. The progress going forward can't be driven by data scientists alone. There is a value challenge. This value challenge is really, really important. Because it's not, you're not getting this value until you actually reach production. Usually, it's the time to market from the development cycle that takes time. It's the fact that only 50%-ish about big data projects succeed. And I mean, by the time you develop something and then going into productionization, it's probably already obsolete. Most of us are in a business, and the business of business is business. So, what is AnalyticsOps? When we talk about AnalyticsOps, it's about taking the best practices from analytics, from DevOps, and operations. It's about joining these things together. IT have had problems for many, many years, and they realized it. So how do you go into production? Right? AnalyticsOps is taking this same mindset but applying it to analytics. So if you want to reach production, it's about taking those things, the flexibility, the exploration, the discovery, all the data science part, but realizing that the maintenance and operation part is equally important in order to get any value whatsoever. So when you are doing AnalyticsOps, what are you doing? You are turning data science from some sort of isolated experiment into a consistent operational framework. We're talking production. We're talking about being able to run the same process over and over again. When we are saying AnalyticsOps, it's about ensuring audit, automated testing, continuous monitoring, quick deployment, and fast retraining of your models. Think big, start smart, scale fast. If any of you have ever been in a company with an IT organization that takes anywhere from 6 to 12 months, you've probably been in one of the old legacy organizations in the Nordics or in the world. IT deployments used to take and still take a long time. The same way is applicable to model deployment. These two are comparable. Data science is software development. You're writing code. That means if you write code and if you're making models, you need to think the same way as you do for software deployment. You can't take 6 to 12 months as you do in this picture on the left side. You can't take 6 to 12 months because you'll be obsolete already. You want to take hours, maximum days, no more than a week ever to go into production with a new model. So it's about changing your business. Slow processes, fast time to market. Manual deployment, automated deployment. Lack of governance, increased governance. might sound very easy, might sound very obvious, but it's actually really, really hard to accomplish. You need a framework to want to do that. You need best practices. You need to understand software. So, conceptually speaking, because we're starting high and we're going low. Conceptually speaking, when we talk about analytics ops, it's about the exploration, your data science part of things. Doing the data science in a good and consistent manner. Allowing the data scientists to use the tools that they want to use and work in the environments they want to work. And as soon as they're done, being able to deploy it and automate that. In addition, being able to integrate with your data pipeline and your integration forms for consummation. Right? Conceptually, it looks really nice. Conceptually, it looks quite easy and quite obvious. But as soon as you start taking one or two more steps down, it becomes more and more advanced. So, next level. When we then talk about analytics ops, and when we talk with software engineers, and when we talk with data scientists, these cases is that you usually have a data scientist, as mentioned, that do your model development. They use tools like Python. Well, Python is not a tool, it's a language. But they use scikit-learn usually, associated with Python. Jupyter Notebooks. Most of your data scientists usually use a Jupyter Notebook today. R, RStudio. Things that are not mentioned here might be SAS, SPSS, there's a lot of things out there. What we want to enable, and I think the community wants to enable, is the possibilities for the data scientists to use whatever tool they want and run that in isolation. That's why we're going to talk about Docker, containerization, quick deployment. So when we are seeing people using the tools and building the models, we talk about continuous integration. So doing version control, doing and using things like Git, your GitHub, your Bitbucket, there are plenty of tools out there. Version control is the key to being able to automate. Building your model pipelines, utilizing tools like Jenkins, awesome tools, really easy to use, in my opinion. So, you then can go up, and you can scale these things. You can run production pipelines and update models, capturing metadata about your models. I work with so many data scientists. They go out, build a model, write down the results or store them in a notepad, and then apply that model to get a score, and then put that into a database, and never check it out. Capturing the metadata about your models. What was the accuracy? What was the features that we used? What was all the things associated with that specific model when we built it? Storing that in a metadata management catalog, in a NoSQL database, you can access it from your BI tools. That's what you want to do. Because that enables also the next part. The next part being automatic retrain, running champion challenger models. Right? We're starting to get more and more advanced on how you can do these things. It's not just about training a model and writing a piece of paper about it. It's about taking that model, putting it into production really fast, and then write and create 10 new models, put them into production the same way, and have them compete about who can generate the best results. And as soon as you start seeing results deteriorate, automatic retraining. You're making your data scientists use their skills as data scientists and not spend the time on maintenance. Right? Automate what can be automated. Let's talk process and not processes. Consistent way of doing the same thing over and over again. Right? You have your data science lab, and I'm sure many of you these days now have a data science lab, or something very similar. The place where the magic happens, where your data scientist sits, where the AI and the machine learning is being done. Imagine then that you have that lab in a consistent way. Everybody's writing code in their own containerized environments, Docker or whatever it might be. We have a few examples up here. Then they are pushing that into Git. You have somebody actually watching the code and improving the code and merging the code. It has a little bit more experience, right? Always a good thing to have second pair of eyes to ensure you're doing the right thing. Then, when they have actually improved it, continuous integration and continuous development, deployment, going in, doing the retraining, doing the training of the models, capturing the metadata, building all these things, automatically scaling up. You can do that anywhere, as long as you have an environment to support it. You can go cloud if you want, you can do on-prem if you want, you can use Kubernetes if you want. It doesn't matter. The process matters. You show the technology doesn't matter. Choose what's the best for your company. And then when you have done that, you obviously want to have an unapproved model, look at it, what was the results, have the senior data scientist or the team manually do control, because you get a report out, right? You're getting a report out with those numbers, looks okay, let's go. Pressing OK in your continuous integration tools or your dashboards, going to the next level. All of a sudden, in the end, you've created automated reports with all the information about your models. You then start involving the business side of things, then things become really scary. It used to be IT. They took a model from development into production, you know, writing your SAS code, giving that to a developer who translates it into COBOL and puts it on mainframe. Automating the entire process, creating reports for approval, pushing that decision into the business side, having the product owner or a chair model actually approve that we put that into production, it's a game changer. Business needs to take responsibility. They say they want to drive value from data science and data. You're part of the game. So, it is not simple. As I said, conceptually it looks really nice. I love these shiny diagrams that says the world is easy. Analytics is not easy when you want to go into production in a consistent manner and be able to do it over and over again. This is an example of one of our deployments that we did with a customer. And you can see this is still in a rather conceptual way, but it shows you the dev, test, pre-prod, prod cycle of things. How you go from a data lab and getting a common data format, working with the different tool sets, and then utilizing your version control and your master, building your bundles, building your setup, building your integration points with different open source technologies. Everything that can be monitored with your normal monitoring UIs, your BI tools, and your approved UIs, before you actually store the metadata and your models somewhere. So you can then go quite easily into production. It's not an easy process, but it's not something that's unaccomplishable. So some of the key things that we use and other people use out there is that we work a lot with Docker containerization. We work with a lot with kind of standardizing these things, utilizing open source. We love working with Docker on Kubernetes. We love using model metadata management. We love working with Git. And we love putting these things together because it works. It's proven. So, how long does it take to do something? It depends. So when I go in and when I work with customers and estimate what's the efforts associated with these things, it obviously depends on the business case. A lot of you might say that I'm just doing one simple model. Why do I need to spend a lot of time and effort in investing and investigating tools like Jenkins, tools like Docker? I got a data lake. I want to run a model in Spark. Why can't I just create a prune job and run that periodically? Sure, yeah. had a discussion the other day. I want to do that in a data warehouse. I want to run my models in a data warehouse. I have five of them. We started then discussing, okay, you have five models today. What do you do? Well, first, obviously, I pull the data out. I do a bit of modeling, I create a model, and then I send it off to IT, and if I'm lucky, it takes an hour to go to production. That's pretty fast. A few days to build a model, a return model or something, giving that to IT one time. Okay, well, what happens as soon as you start seeing problems with the model? Well, then I go in and I investigate, might spend a day on trying to figure those things out, then do a retraining, have a lot of discussion on what to do, and then put it into production. Okay, so you have five models now, and you're doing that on a continuous basis. How many models can you maintain and keep track of with the results and everything? 5, 10-ish. You can do that. But if you want to be able to scale out, so now the data scientists are extremely expensive resources because they are scarce. So if you want to be able to scale beyond 5, 10, 15, 20 per person to 100, 200, 1,000, do you know how many models companies like Netflix run or Google? I mean, it's not going to be less, it's going to be more. Right? We could train an entire population of Sweden and Nordics to be able to do these things, but I would prefer to automate as much as possible. So that's why when we do these things, it depends, obviously. If you're having a smaller problem, usually in infrastructure in place, let's say it takes 8 to 10 weeks to run something like this, identify what is your use case. Is it batch or online? That's a major difference. Batch use cases are usually much easier, right? Because you don't need to real-time stream, update, etc. If you're doing real-time, take somewhere where you have a lot of complexity, 16, 20 minutes to do something like that. And as mentioned in the opening slides, it's not about a data scientist. AI, machine learning, deep learning, all those things require specific skills. When you're hiring a data scientist, are you going to hire a generalist or a specialist? Are you going to hire somebody that's a specialist in deep learning technique, focus on a certain area in a certain industry? You're going to focus on a data scientist that's more business oriented? When you are composing and when you're scaling out, it's about the entire team. It's project management. It's IT. It's your data scientist, a crucial part, obviously. But so is the DevOps. So it's about merging, identifying, and building. It's not about one person or one team of data scientists. It's about everybody together building the future for that company. And on that note, I think we're done. Thank you.